All right, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Greg Fischer, the mayor of Louisville, here to talk about what's going on with COVID-19. Obviously, we're seeing a resurgence in our cases, so it's really important that everybody understands what's going on and what you can do about it to stem the flow of this pandemic. We're obviously seeing a record number of cases nationwide in terms of new positives. We're seeing spikes here in Kentucky as well. Some of the states to the south and southwest of us are just really out of control in terms of Florida, Arizona, some parts of Texas. And we've got to do everything we can to make sure that does not visit our Commonwealth. Actions are being taken. Yesterday, the governor reduced the number of people allowed at private gatherings from 50 back to 10. And he instructed people to quarantine if they're coming back to Kentucky from states with high positivity rates. So unfortunately, this is some of the states where people are going to vacation. I completely support these moves. Look, we are way past the point of denying that this virus is out there and it's some kind of hoax. I mean, it obviously cannot be messed around with, and it is rampaging throughout many parts of our country right now. I am announcing today that I've signed an executive order extending the state of emergency in our city. I first signed that in March, and it had been set to expire on July 31st, and I'd hope circumstances might allow us to get that to expire, but clearly they have not. So I'm extending the state of emergency through August 31st related to this pandemic. And that allows Metro government additional flexibility in our operations so we can respond as quickly as possible to challenges presented by the COVID-19 virus here in our city, which there are many. This extension does not change the status of Metro parks and other city facilities. That remains as is, status quo for now, though we may revisit that depending on if cases rise or fall in the next few weeks, and of course, further action by the governor if any statewide action is taken as well. So we're extending the state of emergency related to COVID out to August 31st. We're just at a point where hopefully everybody understands what they can do. We certainly have talked about that. And the bottom line is, we have to do all we can, and that means each and every one of us, regardless of what your age is. This crisis has to be taken seriously. That means we have to adjust our behavior, or we're going to see more suffering and more deaths. That's the bottom line. More job losses, more business closing the door forever, but we can control that. I hope we all agree these numbers escalating are not acceptable for our community. But then when we say that, then we have to say, okay, what is it that I can do? And the thing is, we know what we can do, right? There are successful models out there, and we can control this. We did a really good job compared to other cities and states at the beginning of this virus in March, and then all the way up through maybe the last week or two, I would say 2 or 3 weeks, when things started opening up more. It seems like people said, okay, the virus is gone. Virus is not gone, obviously, and it's given us a big reminder. For context, in this last week, we've added 660 confirmed positive cases here in Louisville. Contrast that to South Korea as a country. Their population is 50 million. Our 660 confirmed in our population of about 775,000 is more than they had in their entire country of 50 million. So, in Taiwan and New Zealand and other countries around the world that have managed this virus properly, life looks like normal, like it used to be. Here's a couple images from these countries. People are getting together at sporting events, and they're sitting and they're cheering together. And remember what a nightmare New York was a couple months ago? They've got it under control. So they flatten their curve and they're moving forward. So if folks in these places can beat back COVID-19, we definitely can as well. And we're not anywhere near what's going on to the south and southwest of us, but we're just, the purpose of this communication and others is making sure we're doing everything we possibly can so we are not that way. We know what to do as a city government. We're doing that. More testing, more contact tracing. Those efforts continue to ramp up. And again, we know what to do as individuals, right? Everybody can repeat it after me. Social distancing, washing hands, staying home, wearing a mask. It's the basics. There's nothing really complicated about this. The virus transfers from person to person. So the more we put barriers in place or don't go out, virus isn't going to transfer. So please remember to do that, because if we all stick together on this, we all win. And of course, you never know who the next victim of this is going to be. So the way we turn around these cases is sticking together with a citywide plan. As I go out to the grocery store, I do see pretty good mask compliance, 85-90%. Let's get to 100%, because it just takes one super spreader, somebody that's got the virus, to really infect lots and lots of people. So let's keep moving forward on doing what we know we need to do. So let's take a look at today's data. As of today, and we're in our 131st day of monitoring this virus, by the way. As of today, we've had 5,331 COVID-19 cases in Louisville. 140 of those are new. Total 231 deceased, thankfully none since yesterday. So that's good news. Our positivity rate is about 6.83%. And let's remember that these numbers don't represent everybody, because there's more people out there that have COVID than shown on here of these 78,078 tested and 3,721 recovered and 81 newly recovered. We also know that COVID-19 has hit our communities of color in a disproportional manner. On our deceased, 66% white, 27% black, 4% Asian. Our black population is part of the total. Louisville is around 22-23%. So you can see a slight disproportionality with our black community. Our Hispanic Latino community, it's interesting, 16% of the confirmed cases, but only 3% of our deaths. Okay. In terms of our first responders, let me provide an update on those. Overall, 69 Louisville first responders have tested positive since the crisis began. As of today, 62 of them are back at work and the rest are recovering at home. Metro Corrections, oftentimes a hotspot for jails, 2,112 inmates have been tested since the outbreak began. We've seen 28 positive tests out of that, so that's very good. Again, do we have the power to change this? Answer is yes. Okay, what's the number one thing? Stay home, socially distance, wear a mask, okay? That's, in my mind, how you show your love and respect for the people in your life and the people with whom we share this wonderful city. And here's a video from our Metro TV team that illustrates what I'm talking about. So let's launch that video.
We love Louisville.
There's so much to love about Louisville and the people who live here.
For our city to stay healthy,
we all need to do our part.
I wear a mask to protect you and them.
And you wear a mask to protect me and us.
Let's all wear a mask
to stop the spread of coronavirus
and help save lives.
When you wear a mask,
you show that you care about our city
and its beautiful residents. Show your love for Louisville.
Show your love for all of us.
Please wear a mask.
Please wear a mask. Those guys are sanitation workers and professionals. They pick up our garbage, so at least we can do is show respect for them, too. They got a tough job wearing your mask, all right? Now, when you think about where to wear your mask, it's especially important, any kind of social gathering, because what we're seeing is that a lot of the community spread, the spread of the virus that's going on, can be traced to social gathering, particularly among younger adults. So there's been a surge in cases amongst people ages 20 to 44, and one place where we know the virus is spreading is in bars. We've seen that here in our city, and we've seen it big time down in Texas and Florida. So be careful. Bars were allowed to reopen under the governor's Healthy at Work plan under some strict guidelines, but not everybody's following those guidelines. So we're seeing people not wearing masks, standing close together, pulling tables together, and that's just not smart. That's what led Florida, Texas, and California to reclose bars. In Michigan, more than 100 COVID-19 cases were traced to a single restaurant and bar. So we will take that action here if we don't see better compliance here this coming weekend as our health inspectors are out and about. So please, to our bar owners, do everything you can to make sure that you're following the protocols put in place by the governor. And if everybody does that, we're in good shape. For patrons, if you're outside of the bar waiting to get in, wear your mask, keep your distancing. This is where we're seeing that we have a problem. that and family gatherings, getting together, people traveling, bringing the virus back with them and spreading it in their family. So we just need people to be smart and be cautious everywhere during this pandemic, and including places where you might go to relax and unwind, especially there. Okay? Virus does not relax or unwind, so we can't either. All right, with that, let's turn it over to Sarah Moyer. She's our Director of Public Health and Wellness, Chief Health Strategist, well-known in the city. Dr. Moyer, take it away.
Thanks, Mayor. Well, like you mentioned, we are here today and added this extra press briefing because cases are significantly increasing and hospitalization numbers are starting to increase as well. And this is because the virus doesn't move, people move, and people are moving a lot more now in Louisville. When we look at the data, people in Louisville are almost moving as much as back in March. So in order to reverse these trends again, we need to slow down and reduce the number of people we are all coming in contact with. So the governor reduced the number of people who can gather from 50 to 10. And he and Dr. Sack are also recommending that anyone who's traveled to a hotspot state quarantine for 14 days. So what does that mean? It's the same thing you need to do if you came in contact with someone who has been diagnosed with COVID. That's staying inside your home, no going to work, no going out for anything, even groceries. The only exception is going out for medical care or calling 911 for an emergency. Do not have visitors or family over. You need to be checking your fever twice daily and keep a record. If you experience any symptoms, call your medical provider immediately to get tested. And to repeat, the symptoms looking for are fever over 100, respiratory symptoms such as shortness of breath, difficulty breathing, loss of taste or smell, diarrhea, headache, and there's many others that are listed on our website and on the CDC's website. Even if you get tested and it's negative, you still need to wait the 14 days. Testing is a point in time test, and there's a good chance that you just got tested too soon. So some of these hotspot areas include Alabama, Arizona, Florida, Georgia, Idaho, Nevada, South Carolina, Texas, Mississippi, and Puerto Rico. There are so many excellent places to vacation in Kentucky. So I guess to help us support our local economy and spend your vacation dollars right here at home. But when you visit those wonderful places in Kentucky, you still need to wash your hands, wear your mask, and limit your contacts. Now I'm going to shift gears a little bit and answer some questions, which my team has been getting. So where are all these new cases coming from? The answer goes back to reopening and the more people we're in contact with. So some of the biggest contributions are related to travel to hotspot areas, indoor social gatherings like bars and house parties, workplaces, and camps and sports. And then when a family member gets a case, it's been infecting households. There's no evidence that the rise in cases so far has been a result of protests. So if you travel, stay home for 14 days, avoid social interactions like indoor bars and indoor house parties, and make sure your workplace is following the healthy at work guidelines. And if they're not, please call 311 to report, and our health department employees will help them come in compliance. If someone in your house has symptoms, please make sure they're isolating away from others in your home until their test results come back. If it's positive, you need to keep doing that for 10 days. Question two, what should I do if I've been exposed? So the safest advice is to stay home and self-isolate for 14 days. Monitor yourself for symptoms. If you develop symptoms, call your provider to get a test. And you can call the COVID-19 hotline at any time if you have questions at 1-800-722-5725 or your healthcare provider. Question three, what should I do while I wait for my results? Stay home and self-isolate while you wait. If you thought you were at risk enough to get tested or have symptoms, we don't want you exposing others in our community. People are most infectious in those first few days that they have symptoms. And so that time period while you wait for your test result is the most important time to be staying home. While you're bored at home, start making a list of anyone you were in contact with in the 48 hours before you started to have symptoms. If any of them were within 6 feet of you for 10 minutes or more, they are considered a high-risk exposure. If your test result comes back positive, these are the people our contact tracing team will help you identify to stay home. Last question, question four. I tested positive. Why is it taking so long for me to get a call? So often our labs contact you before they report the lab to us. They may wait until the end of the day or send us results in a batch, often by fax, which we then have to enter into the system manually. We're also seeing more people getting screening tests done in the city. These are the antibody or antigen tests, and expect a call from the health department. We only call if you have a positive PCR test, which is that nasal swab test. Your physician who did the antibody or antigen test needs to send in the paperwork to show that you have had symptoms in order for us to call about those screening tests. So we know you're anxious, and we are working very hard to make your wait at home short as possible. But in the meantime, make sure you're staying at home, away from others, and call your doctor for advice. You can also get started on calling your contacts who are exposed. Call anyone on your list who is exposed and notify them that you tested positive. Ask them to self-isolate and monitor themselves for symptoms for 14 days. So remember, we are in this together. The pandemic has shown how everyone's health depends on cooperation. The choices we make today will determine what we can do next month. So please keep wearing a mask, wash your hands, limit your contact with others, and if you test positive or think you may have symptoms, please stay home. Thanks, Mayor.
Thank you, Dr. Moore. I appreciate that. So for any of our media friends, if you'd like to put your questions in the chat, we'll do that. We'll get to the all the coronavirus questions. First, I'll address one of them as it relates to protests. We're getting a question in here from Wave 3. Are you aware of the NFAC group claiming to come to Louisville on Saturday? What's the city doing to prepare for possible visit with this? Yes, we're obviously fully aware of that. LMPD is in touch with the protest group to understand what their goals are so we can make sure that we arrange a peaceful protest. And they'll have all the plans in place to do that, and there could be counter-protest as well. So this is not unusual, so we will be prepared to deal with it as need be. All right, let's get into the COVID questions. Dr. Moyer, you just want to kind of go through them? You want me to read them to you? I guess I'll read them so everybody knows what they are here. We'll start off with, Laura Ellis. Governor Beshear says everyone should regularly get tested. Is that true for Louisville? Or should we be saving tests for people with symptoms? Do we have enough tests to meet demand?
So tough question. So right now, I mean, that was true when we could get test results back in 24 hours and we didn't have very many people with symptoms. Now, because of hotspots areas across the country, a lot of those big national labs that our community screening sites were using are taking 7 to 10 days to turn around. So that point, there's not really a point to be getting tested. And plus the diagnostic test, that PCR nasal swab test, is best when you have symptoms. So talk to your physician about the best way to get tested. Sometimes those antigen tests are a good way to get for screening. Otherwise, right now, definitely get tested if you have symptoms. And if you're at another high risk scenario, like a nursing home or our corrections facility, we have plans in place to help them with general screening testing.
Marcus Green asks, what's the current 7-day average positivity rate, and how does that compare with the same rate 1 week ago and 2 weeks ago, respectively? Do you have that data handy?
I believe it's Grace on to answer the questions about the positivity rate.
Grace Simrall, are you in the house?
I am trying to get on. Can you all see me and hear me?
There you are. Yep. Hey, Grace.
Hello, everyone. So as we've stated before, when we shared our public-facing dashboard, we use the best available data to inform the public and make decisions. That said, what we have are cumulative confirmed cases, and we have cumulative total tests administered. The only way to accurately get the 7-day average positivity rate would be, in fact, to know of the batch of tests administered, how many of those came back positive. We do not have that data available to us, and that's why we provide the cumulative rate.
And you want to explain why we don't have the data?
The systems that collect the data just don't parse it that way. So the best we can do currently is to be able to provide cumulative, which at this point, again, given the limitations around the data, is less than 7%.
And is that, you want to talk about the problem with getting all of the tests? So because this next question we have here, it says, experts have said that municipalities with positivity rates over 5% should consider rolling back reopening plans to get the virus under control. Why haven't you considered further rollbacks? And what positivity rate would you consider rollbacks? So we want to talk about, we're consistent in what we're, how we're reporting positivity, but we're not getting all of the tests that have been administered to really understand the true positivity rate. Would you like to elaborate on that?
Sure. Again, to calculate positivity rate, you take the confirmed case count and you divide it by the number of tests administered. In our case, we know the confirmed case count, but we don't have a complete number of the total tests administered. There's various settings that aren't reporting into the state in a timely fashion, which just creates challenges for all of us. And that's why we recommend that the public look at this number in terms of a trend and directionality and not necessarily as an absolute number. In fact, we strongly suspect, based on other information that hospitals are telling us, our overall community positivity rate is much lower than our current listed value.
And that would be, just again, be simplistic, because we're not getting all of the tests reported. We only get the negatives back. So
we're not getting all of the negatives, correct.
So the important thing is the trend that we see, and we want to continue it. And we apologize that we don't have the data. The data is not available to us. So, but the trend obviously is, and that ties into the 5% question on whether or not we should consider rolling back reopening plans. You heard me talk about bars, and bars need to really do a better job. This weekend, the governor's rolled back gatherings from 50 to 10 people. So if the trend is not reversed, you can expect further activity in this area. Okay, let's see. Dr. Moyer, you said hospitalizations are increasing. Do you have the data on hospital occupancy rates for COVID patients and the current capacity of ICU beds and ventilators? Or Grace, to you.
Grace, I'll let you take that one first, and I'll add anything.
So again, bear in mind that things such as hospitalization and hospital occupancy rates continue to fluctuate. These are near real-time numbers. But again, what we're seeing right now from the hospital systems is that we have plenty of capacity, and we're working on better ways of being able to communicate that to the public, you know, for more transparency. But for the time being, be aware that we track this and that there is adequate capacity.
And you want to explain why? Just explain why we don't have the data. This is, we're very frustrated with this as well.
Well, I mean, part of it is we have a different reporting needs. So I think it's been well covered in the national media that Health and Human Services, the Department of Health and Human Services, has been having the hospital systems transition over to a new system for reporting their hospital data. And that's impacting our ability to get access to it. In addition, from a daily perspective, as we've noted, in particular on ICU and ventilators, when you have such low numbers, it's easy to accidentally or inadvertently re-identify people. We have an obligation to protect patient privacy. And so we're working through these concerns with our partners in the hospital systems.
So that I think Marcus Green nicely says, respectfully, the data doesn't help anyone understand anything. I'm not sure what you're talking about there, Marcus, if that's the positivity. But he follows it up with, why can Kentucky and Indiana, the state level, provide the information, I guess, around positivity and hospitalization, but the city of Louisville cannot?
And again, the data is not organized that way. It's not categorized at the county level. It's categorized at the state level.
We wish that was not the case, Marcus. We can get some individual hospital reporting. It runs into the problem that Grace talked about. So we recognize this is a problem. We're trying to find a way through the healthcare protection laws right now and the data aggregation so we can be more discreet with our, or more specific with our reporting. Okay. Yeah, so Marcus said that was about the positivity rate. So again, I think we've answered that, Marcus. It's like, since we're only getting the positive results and not the negatives from everybody, that's why that denominator is smaller in that calculation, and that is a state data bottleneck that we're having. Okay.
And just to emphasize, I think with that, like, the hospitalization numbers are trending up slightly. There's still plenty of capacity today, but that is just, it's just not a great sign that those are starting to trend up. ICU beds are, have plenty of capacity today.
Let's see, last question on here. Are cases of COVID-19 in large warehouses and factories where employees work in close proximity to one another a concern at this time, and how is the city responding? Sarah?
I can answer that. So that's not where a majority of our cases are coming from right now. That was a big issue when they were one of the only businesses open when the rest of us were on stay-at-home orders. We have protocols in place to be doing screening tests and ways for those employees to get tested as soon as they have symptoms, and are working closely with all the factories in the city. So not a big cause of the increase in cases we are currently having. So.
We did hear, you know, JBS Swift early on was a challenge for us. You might just want to talk about then how we arranged for testing at the Family Community Clinic. It was a half block away. This is an example of how we address some of these issues.
Yeah, so we've got testing plans in place for all of the factories. JBS, as an example, yeah, did testing with their employees, and now they've got a contract in place with a local healthcare provider to continue that on an ongoing basis. So, monitoring it closely, but not a cause of the recent increase in cases.
All right, folks, that is all of the questions on there. Obviously, the big takeaway, the trend is not our friend right now in terms of upward moving with the trend. So please, let's just communicate through the media about these basics that everybody can do to keep us safe with masks and distancing, staying at home, and washing our hands. So we've seen other places get this under control. Our big question is, when are we going to flatten out? We don't know that. We're peaking and we're still increasing like we are right now. So we know what to do. Let's do it. Thanks for joining us today.